Hey, welcome to Show and Tell, the two mortgage guys. We come to you live every Tuesday on Facebook and YouTube at noon. Today, we happen to be interviewing Joe Wampler with Alpha Appraisers. Some of the things we're going to sort of try to figure out in this process with it is what we're going to get with appraisers revealing all what you're going to find out about your home before you put it up for sale, et cetera.
So, Joe was born and raised in Kokomo, Indiana, and has two children that both reside here in Kokomo. He's been in the appraisal business for 23 years. Joe says he enjoys living in this community and thinks some of the greatest people in the world live here too. We're super excited to have Joe on a show with us. Welcome to the show, Joe.
Thank you guys for having me on your show today.
Hey, you're welcome. Good seeing you in person.
This is our first live. Like, right. Normally we get to hide behind cameras and not look at each other. And so
make sure I look.
Yeah. You look great.
Right. Exactly.
Well, hey, look, we want to talk about home values, the appraisal process. Let's kind of get into, like, how do you calculate a value? Like, if someone's going to buy a home, how do you go in and actually do the homework to figure out what it's worth?
The whole process is based on the principal substitution. So we would look at what your house is like, your similar square footage, similar amenities, bedroom count, condition, year built, houses like that, that we would compare yours to, that other buyers would do the same. If you go to car lot, one car is a red neon and you're looking for a neon, and another car lot has a red neon and about the same, and there's a price difference, the principal substitution is that you would probably, you know, go with the one that is a better buy. So it's all basically laying things side by side in a comparison analysis based on the principal substitution.
Yeah, that's good. I like the car analogy, because, like, we've always talked about the clients that, hey, they're going to go out and do some comparable houses,
sure,
but to use a vehicle like that, yeah, then they can associate with a lot more.
Where are you going to look at this? Like, what do you access?
The MLS, MyBoar, if we're down in the area, Indianapolis area, also Beacon, private sales that we have, as far as estate sales, things of that nature, knowledge that we have from the business.
Pulling back through on that. So if somebody's, you know, getting ready to, in a normal market, put their house up for sale. We know we're sort of abnormal right now because things are just flying off the shelf. But normally, people always want to try to do something for the curb appeal on the house. What is some of the things somebody might do to the house that really is not going to add value compared to something they could do that would add value?
Any kind of an over improvement. If every house in your neighborhood has a stone driveway and you go and put in a new concrete driveway, you're not going to get all that money back in the process of selling the property. It's not going to be there. Now, the reverse is also true. If you're in a neighborhood that has all concrete driveways and yours needs replaced and you decide to put in a gravel driveway, it's usually going to be reflective in the buyer's agreement to purchase the property. That's going to be borne out in that, you know, that person's going to say, hey, I don't want to be the only one living in this neighborhood with a gravel driveway. So it would be reflective in the price. But anything that's an over improvement, you know, you go to, and swimming pools are a big question that a lot of people have. You get down in the Orlando, Florida area, nearly every house has a swimming pool. And if you don't, it's considered a negative thing on your house. Huh. In Indiana, it's hard for us to give too much money for a pool because there's not a whole lot of houses that have pools. There's certain things here that, you know, you don't have air conditioning here. That's obviously going to be a bigger deal here than it would be in a climate that doesn't get as hot as we do. So anything that's an over improvement, you're probably not going to get your money back. Things you could do to make your house more appealing would be, obviously, get your grass cut. If you've got some dead grass, get that. If you've got some peeling paint, fix the peeling paint, missing shingle, cracked window, rip screens, things like that that would make it presentable. You don't want somebody to come up and be like a shark on blood, find one thing that you've neglected. And then, obviously, you know, if a guy's neglected something that's that obvious to the eye and the observer, casual observer, there's probably other things he's neglected as well.
There you go. You
know, it's kind of like a shark on blood.
Right.
So I tell people too, like, there's a difference between sellability and maybe appraised value, right?
Sure,
like,
absolutely.
There's things you can do that will make your home more presentable, attractive. Yeah. It may get you a higher offer,
correct,
but it doesn't necessarily equate to appraisal level.
That's 100%. There's a value in use. You know, right now with what we've got going on in Kokomo, there are people that can look at a house. Some people they want a 2.5 bath. A 2 bath just simply won't do it for them. And you don't, may never know. They could have bladder condition. It may just be they want that. You know, you don't know.
Right.
And so when you look at a house and somebody says, hey, it doesn't have 2.5 baths. I'm sorry, it doesn't suit my needs. Those certain things there, there are other people that I just sold my house and I had 3.5 baths and had 3 full baths and 1/2 bath, which was an overkill. I was probably one of the only houses like that in my price range, which was not a high price range, that was like that. So certain things like that people are going to want. Years ago, basements were not a big deal from probably 1975 until, what was it, 1997 or 6, 8, whatever, when the tornado ran through Greentown.
Right.
Was the first one, the precursor. Yeah. Then when they came through over there in that area, Paul through in Union Street and hit over there by Highland Park. So then you've seen a resurgence in buyers that said, hey, we want a basement. We want a place to go in a tornado.
Yeah.
Well, if you've been through a tornado and your house was affected, you might want a basement. That becomes a big deal. Somebody else that's never been around a tornado doesn't care about that. So those things, you know, you can't give a lot of value for a basement, especially a 100-year-old home with an unfinished basement, but it does give the buyer peace of mind that says, hey, I've got a place to go if a tornado decides to rip loose on me.
Right. So question on that, because that's sure. Something else always gets brought up is, you know, the basement or living areas down in there. It, if it has some type of like an, is it called egress,
but you still can't count it as square footage or living space. Does not mean you cannot give a value. You just cannot consider it GLA, gross living area, or what the lay term would be square footage. Now, they did recently just change what constitutes a finished basement from an unfinished basement. For years in this industry, your basement had to be finished in a manner consistent with the rest of the home, the upper level, the first floor, second floor, whatever. They have recently changed that to where if you have a house basement and it's coated with paint, not peeling or epoxy, even if it has concrete walls and the walls are painted or epoxy, and then in your ceiling, generally speaking, you would, most appraisers would want you to have some sort of a drop ceiling, acoustic tile, drywall. However, they are making a trend toward it where some appraisers are saying, we're going to consider this finished if you have painted it, even if you can look up and see ductwork. And it makes sense because if you go eat at a Texas Roadhouse and you look up, the ceiling is painted black. You can see the ductwork. It's there. Obviously, the ceiling height in a basement would, you know, you need to be high enough, usually 6'6" or greater. So it needs to be usable without the average person.
Not ducking down all over the places.
And while we're on that square footage, they just made a change that just took place like March the 1st, I think was the date, considering upper levels where you measure on like Cape Cods and things of that nature. In order for anything to be considered, we've always had to have 5 foot height from the ceiling to the floor. But now with the area that has a 5 foot ceiling height on the outer edge, it has to have a 7 foot ceiling height, and half of the room must have a 7 foot ceiling height to count that as square footage.
Wow. Okay.
Now that is for conventional. FHA has not adopted that. VA has not adopted it. It's actually regarded as ANSI, ANSI measuring standards. So Cape Cods and things, theoretically in defense of real estate agents, they may have sold your house 6 months ago, may show 1400 square feet. You get it today, you get a buyer who's using a conventional loan, conventional appraisals done, that square footage would not show up in the square footage now on an appraisal.
Good, because of the slope and all that stuff. And then what constitute that 7 foot span?
It has to be, if it's just to make it easy, if we're talking an area where we put a tape measure, the walls angle down and it's 5 foot from here to here. So we come over from what would be the corner and it's 5 foot. And over here we go where it's 5 foot. If this area was 20 foot wide, in order for that to be considered, there must be 50% of that, 10 foot of that would have to have a ceiling height of 7 foot or greater to be counted.
And if not, then it's out.
It's not, it is not considered gross living area. We could give you some sort of value for it. Obviously, it wouldn't be the same as gross living, but what it would do, in a, let's just use a 1400 square foot, 1000 on the first floor, what was 400 square foot up, if we cannot count that because it doesn't meet the 7 foot, you know, height requirement of half of the area, the floor area, what we'd have to do is be reduced down to using comps that are 1,000 square foot. We could make some sort of adjustment for the 400, but the anchor, we would be dealing with a 1,000 square foot home, not a 1,400. Mm-hmm. So when I go look for comps, I've got to look for a 1,000 square foot.
There you go. Which you're going to run into different price ranges.
Exactly. Exactly. Right. It's going to be reflective.
Andrew. So in my personal home, we've got these crazy high ceilings, right? Mm-hmm. Or in our roof lines.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got this monster attic space like in our bedroom closet, and the way it kind of connects to the house, I've often looked at that and thought, man, if you could reinforce that, you could literally put another room up there. Something like that's going to add value if I can count the square footage, or like what you just explained, though.
Right.
Even if you can't count it, it's still going to attribute some type of value. Absolutely. It's finished.
Exactly. And that would come back to where your buyer that looks at it says, I need that nook area because I have a lot of Christmas things I want to store, or I want a place that my grandkid can go have a drum set and beat on the drum set and not drive me crazy. Someone that needs that, that's going to be determined when they look at it. So the, you know, we talk about appraised value, market value. If you want to know what something's worth, put it up for sale.
Yeah.
And in this market, there obviously there's some people paying more than appraised value for homes. And the question I always get asked is, where are people getting all this money? Well, if you've lived in your house for 20 years and you bought it back 20 years ago and you sell it today, you've made a pretty good profit. So you have expendable income there, or money that has come in, not income, but you have money. You could afford to go pay a little more for what you wanted now because you made money through appreciation. So that's what people say, where are they getting the extra money? Generally, your people that are buying are people that have a house they sold, and they have sold it and they're making money, and therefore they're buying another home, and they may be able to pay over appraised value because they're bringing some cash to closing or cash to the table.
I've got another question that comes up a lot on refinances. Okay, so we're going to do a refinance for somebody who, and maybe they're pulling cash or whatever it is.
Sure.
We have to have an appraisal done possibly. And they always want to like, well, can we get a week? Because we want to clean the house and all this stuff. How much does somebody picking up, tidying up, cleaning their house have any impact at all when you come in and do your job?
I'm there to appraise the property, which is the structure and the things attached to it. I'm not there to appraise housekeeping.
We just saved so many people so much time.
Don't sweat it.
On house cleaning. I mean, right there. That's
cut your
watching
grass.
The show for somebody.
Rather than painting that area on the roof that bugs you inside the ceiling or whatever it is, cut your grass and make it look good from the outside. We're not there to grade your housekeeping skills.
Right. So yeah, it helps a lot, tremendously. What are the things, Joe, like do you see or maybe questions get brought up when you're in somebody's house, or what are they when you walk in there to take the pictures? They probably hit you with 100 questions, don't they?
Yeah, a lot of them are, what is an appraisal? The greatest definition I can give you of an appraisal is a snapshot in time of the value of your property. Now, it's not only a value of your property and a snapshot in time of your property, but the things that surround it, external influencers. You look at external influencers, things like used to be, this is no longer this way. FHA's done away with this. Used to be, if you had a gas station within like 300 feet and it had an underground tank, that disqualified that from FHA. FHA did away with that requirement, didn't make it publish it to anyone really per se, but now that's not there. So you have, for example, I think they're going to announce, well, they're going to announce Stellantis is going to build a new battery factory here in Kokomo. Anything like that could absolutely have an impact on the value of houses in an area. If you have, if Chrysler would say we're adding 1,000 jobs, all of a sudden you're going to have a lot of people that for all intents and purposes are probably going from lower paying jobs to much higher paying jobs. They're going to be able to get a loan. They're going to need a place to live.
Right.
And that drives it up. If Chrysler would say, you know, I'm sorry, we're shutting off half of our workforce here, we're shutting down, that would have an impact. So obviously, you know, I like to see things coming to Kokomo, jobs coming to Kokomo. Before, also, you're going to notice this even when a lot of people that work here live out of town and drive a good distance with the price of gas. Right. When that equation comes in, you know, you start taking, and that can drive the person says, well, I'm spending $30 a day in gas going to work 5 days a week. $150 a week. And you got to remember, everybody says, well, that's $150 and they divide their income or whatever they get paid an hour. That's not true, because that $150 you're spending is your after tax money. Yeah. So whatever tax bracket you're in, we have to compare apples to apples.
Add that back in there.
Right. Yes. You have to fill that back in and figure that in.
Yep. So easily you could be spending an extra $300-$500 a month in gas to where you'd be beneficial to move back and increase your house payment.
And you'll see some of that will influence that happens. Mm-hmm. Everybody's always, you know, saying, are we headed for a recession? Is that the housing thing is, again, a lot of these people that are paying what the casual observer thinks are exorbitant prices are overpaying. And that does happen. You also understand that a lot of those people are bringing cash to the table and they have that money from the previous real estate they sold. So it looks like it's a false inflation, but that not all that money is being lent. Some people brought money to the table and they're putting that, you know, you bought a house, you want to upgrade, you made a lot of money on yours, you buy another house.
The risk level is different.
Sure, absolutely. The risk, and that's where people try to compare this to 2008, 2009, whatever. Yeah. This is a totally different situation than that. I mean, there's a lot more. You guys are doing a lot more to verify people's incomes, what they say it is. We're not doing stated income. We're not just taking a number. Somebody, you know, there's a lot more checks and balances now than there was then.
Yeah, which helps.
Oh, absolutely.
With all that. And it was tougher. You've been in this for years. Yeah. I mean, it's that same thing. We all went through that, and it was just a going back and do this whole learning curve, and now we've done it. So it's a daily thing now that we.
And we're affordable housing. I mean, we've been known as affordable housing throughout the nation for years. And, you know, people say, well, people are overpaying. The problem is, it would be one thing if the price of just old construction or houses that were built went up. But again, you go back to the principal substitution. You start looking at a house and you say, maybe I can remodel this. When you start going, houses have appreciated, but I assure you that the price of a 2x4 has appreciated just as much as the house has. The price of drywall, the price of paint, the price of carpet, the price of shingles. So it's not like just the housing has inflated or went up. Everything else has. So if you say, I'm going to build new, you start looking at the cost of new sometime, and it's like, hey, let's buy something that's built and we can remodel it and make it adapt to what we want.
Right, because that same pieces that we got.
Sure.
Awesome, Joe. That's like a ton of information with what we've got on, really. And nice to get. There's little nuggets in there that we can pull back out of.
Sure.
What we got on. So sure. We appreciate you taking a few minutes and hanging out.
No problem. As long as what it costs to rent a house or apartment stays above the house payment, what a house payment would be, we're in fairly good shape.
Okay, so that's a good piece.
Yeah. When you start seeing rent go below what a house payment is, that's when red flags need to go up for all of us and realize, hey, it's cheaper to let my house go back and I can go live for $300 a month in a rental somewhere. That becomes an issue. We're far from that.
We're far from that. We're not there at all.
Yeah, they're raising rents and raising everything.
Right.
Well, thanks so much for coming on our show. We appreciate all the feedback.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, make sure if you guys have any questions, you know, you can share and like it. But if you got questions specifically for Joe, just type them in down there. We'll make sure he gets them, then he can respond back to y'all. It's different questions because we know there's tons of them. Sure. We get them daily.
All the time. Right. Thanks again, Joe.
Have a good night. Have a good day.
All right, so next week we've got a big show as well. We're going to be interviewing Troy Steiner with Eric Chevrolet. Troy will be discussing the auto industry. Where are all the cars at? What's going on with car values? How are auto rates doing? All this and more. Be sure to watch us next Tuesday at noon.